So I'm a math teacher at Stuyvesant High School, and I do this lecture about math and music. And first question that I have that I'll pose is, how many different tones can be made on a piano? Everyone take a moment to ponder that. How many different tones, sounds, or different notes are there on a piano? And there's multiple answers because I didn't define this question fully. Might be a little ambiguous, but what's one possible answer? I get volunteers, yes?
88.
Maybe 88, because there are, now this keyboard doesn't have 88 keys, but definitely there are 88 keys on a piano, and every note has a different sound. So 88 is a very valid answer to that question, but it won't be the only answer to the question, yes? So when you play a single note, it's actually a couple of notes being played at the same time. Otherwise, it would sound more like a computer generated note. So different instruments are really you hear this note and it's really it's got a bunch of notes being played together at different volumes. So maybe way more than 88. Anyone think less than 88? Yes. And maybe 12, because somehow, even though this note is higher than this first note, and that second note's higher, and this is higher, but somehow, at some point, is it the same note or is it higher? Well, it's definitely higher, but on the other hand, in some ways, it's kind of like the same note. And that's what we're going to go with today, the idea that in modern music we have these, what's called the 12-tone scale. And I want to tell you about how that developed. How many different notes can you play on a violin? How many different notes can be played on a violin, do you think? Volunteers? Yes? The same 12? It's actually, that is a good answer, but actually it is not the answer, though. Yes?
Some countably infinite number.
Infinity, because on a violin, you can make this, by putting your finger in a different spot, you can make the string become shorter, and it makes the sound a little bit higher. Now on a guitar, you have frets, so you choose to not go in between two notes. But on an instrument like a violin, it's actually an infinite number of notes. Because if you have this note and this note, if you put your finger on the string halfway between those, you get some other note that's in between the notes. And in doing so, you could do an infinite number of notes on a violin. You could do an infinite number of notes on a trombone with a slider. But other instruments, you can't do an infinite number of notes. So the first instruments were something like a harp. And on a harp, you could also, depending on where you want to put those strings, you have a harp, and I'm going to imagine my harp is something like this with a straight line here. I have to decide, where do I want to put my strings? I could put strings close together. I could put them far apart. The longer strings make lower notes, so usually. Usually our harp is actually going this way, and the higher notes are on the right. But somewhere along the line, they had to make a decision. How many different notes do I want to have, not counting the notes that are kind of the same note, and where should they all be? How long should the strings be? What should the frequency of the notes be in order to make music that sounds good? And that took a lot of years to sort of resolve. But first I'll tell you a little bit, a very small piece of physics about why certain notes sound good together. And certain notes don't sound good together. Yeah. Some notes sound good together. and some don't. And why is that? Well, it has a little bit to do with the way sound waves kind of work in your ear. And I'll give you a visual example. If I had a bunch of dots evenly spaced, and underneath it I had another set of dots, but this time there's twice as many dots, that pattern looks pleasing to the eye somewhat. There's some sort of regularity to it where the dots, there's a lot of dots that are kind of lined up. Well, if I take the same seven dots and instead try to squeeze nine dots into that same spot, now suddenly we don't have any dots lining up anymore. Well, the same thing happens in our ears with sound waves, and I'll bring up a little. So for instance, if I were to graph sine x, it looks something like that. It's kind of like a sound wave. If I, on the same graph, put sine 2x, which looks like that, it may not look great together, but they meet up in a bunch of different spots. And that's when that happens, like the vibrations happen in our ear at the same time. And if they happen at the same time, it sounds good. So if my string, what they realized long ago in music is that if I have a string that's a certain length and it makes this tone, and if I cut the string exactly in half and play a tone that sounds like this, and those two notes sound good together, when you cut the length of the string in half, we say the frequency doubles. It's the string vibrates twice as fast. So double the frequency. It sounds so good together that it practically sounds like the same note to us. And that's what's kind of happening in this situation. I think it looks better if I just draw it by hand. If I squeeze a second curve in, so that kind of goes like that, halfway every time, those two curves intersect at a lot of places. But if I try instead to squeeze a curve in with one that's some other fraction, maybe they don't meet up at all, and that's where we end up with this situation that doesn't sound good to us. Now, as I said, you can make as many notes as you want, but the first two notes that you'd always start with are probably something like this. And I'm going to build a little instrument here, and at the same time, I'm going to make a little chart. So here's my instrument, and my first note has a frequency of 1. And my little line here is going to be what the frequency is, not what the length of the string is. So I have a note, and I also want to have a note like this. That second note has a frequency relative to the first one, 2. And that's going to be my starting point. It's called an octave. Just with that, what if I want to go one more octave? What would be the frequency of that really high note I just played? Volunteer for that? Yes? That one is 4. Not 3, but 4, because it's double this one. So it's 4 times the original. Double the original. 4 times the original. So maybe I have out here, maybe I have 3 out here. Let me make this a little. Say I have 1, 2, 3, 4, evenly spaced. 1, 2, this thing would be way up here, 4. And that would be an instrument. And if that's all I knew about music theory, I could make something like that. Anyone know what song, famous song, begins with an octave jump? Anyone want to say it out or raise a hand? Yes? That's right, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. I'm actually not. Thank you.
Well, something like that. There was a very famous song in the 80s. Anyone from grew up in the early 80s? Any of the teachers?
My Sharona.
That does sound like My Sharona. I had more in mind. That does sound just like that. I was thinking. Remember that one?
Safety
Dance. Safety Dance. Men Without Hats. Very good song. I think they were a one-hit wonder, I think. Mr. Kale, can you name another song by Men Without Hats?
What was the name of them?
Men Without Hats?
No.
No, I think that was it for the... But it's a nice example of an octave. So if you have an octave, you can do stuff, but that wouldn't be very interesting music. You'd really have just one note and duplicates of that note with your octaves. So they got an idea. One thing that you can do is, what if I made something three times as big as the original? By making the string one third as big, if I made a string that was triple, how would that stand? The string's not triple. The string's one third, the tone is triple. I find it's better just to draw the length is not the string length, but the frequency. Once, twice, four. Triple the frequency sounds like this. And that's a new note. Now that note is three times as much as this one. If I cut the frequency in half to 3/2, turns to this note. Those are octaves. Take the original note with the note that's 1.5 times as much, and we get this sound. And that's our next note. The notes we're really concerned with are the ones that are between frequencies 1 and 2. So right in the middle of 1 and 2 is 1.5. And now I have a new note. Now, these notes sound good together. This interval is used a lot in movies. That's it. John Williams is the composer that did Star Wars and does like a lot of movies, and he likes this interval. You ever see E.T.? Oh, it starts with that. John Williams is a big fan. Raiders of the Lost Ark has it. That's it. Something like that, but it's a very unique sound. It's actually not considered a very good musical sound. Like there's something missing. Something like that, but not considered really musical to play those two notes, just those two notes together. It always feels like something's missing, but John Williams uses that because it has some kind of an ambiguity to it. Where's it going to go? Is it going to do that or that? Okay. So now we have two notes. Now I can make notes with different things. But one of the first ideas about making different notes is to just pick nice fractions. Somehow, if I pick an ugly fraction, like 15/8, doesn't sound good. 15/8, that's not somehow a nice enough fraction. When you do 15/8, the things don't come together enough. So here's a couple of nice notes, though, that people have come up with. 4/3. Which is, one and a half. So 4/3 is a nice note. Sounds like this. That's a
new note. What most famous song begins with a with that interval? Those people who learn music theory always learn this as a name. Yes, I saw some people. Oh, these guys over here, if you would. Yes? I guess it does start with that. Not the most famous of them, but yes, that is very good. Amazing Grace does start with that interval. The most famous one is Here Comes the Bride. But you are right. Amazing Grace definitely starts. There's only so many notes. But there used to be a game show called Name That Tune. And they'd give like a trivia question, and then the person would say, I can name that tune in four notes. And then the person they're competing with would either say, go ahead, if you do, if they get it, they win. If they don't get it, the other person wins. They would say, I can name that tune in three notes. And the other person would go, I can name that tune in two notes. And they'd work their way down, and the person would say, I can name that tune in one note. Of course, they knew it from the trivia question. And then the person would always say, then they'd have to say, go ahead, name that tune. Everyone just said, the other person just didn't say, I can name that tune in zero notes. But they didn't. You when the other person said one note, that was it. And then they'd go like that, and the person would say, that's, some, Twinkle Twinkle Star, whatever song it was. So that was a good show. Now, four thirds is new note. And now I have three notes. And if I put in my double note, I can make a somewhat relaxing music. That just doesn't really, it's not very interesting music, but those notes do sound nice together. Well, by picking other fractions, you can make other sounds, other notes that sound nice. Like, for instance, 5 over 3, which is about 1.6. That turns out not to be a bad sounding note. And now I have. And one more note that has sort of nice fractions in it is 5 over 4. It's about 1.25. And of course, we get, with the 5 over 4, we get these other higher notes. I'm just going to concentrate on the notes that are between 1 and 2. But 5 over 4 sounds like this. 4 over 3. 3 over 2. 5 over 3. And then 2. So with that, sounds like a little bit, you could imagine in ancient Greece or someone with an instrument that just has those notes, and they play this music that's, somewhat, if played nicely, it could be somewhat soothing, nothing really interesting about it. Now, in modern days, people start to like music that has what's called dissonance, where it doesn't sound so good, but somehow it sounds so bad that it sounds good again. And that's sort of a new modern thing. But back then, they were able to get these five notes, which sound nice. So the question is, well, I could keep going with this. I could pick, so far I've just picked fractions that have numbers 5 or less. And with that, I'm actually stuck. There's actually no more fractions that use numbers less than 5. So I could start saying 6 over 5 and 7 over 4, and I can make infinite number of notes, but how do I decide, when to stop? I can make an infinite number of notes making fractions, and I wouldn't know, when to stop. So they came up with a very cool idea, and this is what's called, what I'm going to teach you about now, is called Pythagorean tuning. Pythagorean tuning says I could get more notes that I'm sure have a good chance of sounding good, not just by making up fractions that have different numbers in them that are small as possible, but the idea of a note sounding okay with 1.5 times that note frequency. If that sounds good together, this is 1, this is 3/2, That must mean that these two, if I take the 3/2 and multiply that by 3/2, I get 9/9/4, which sounds like that. So these sound okay because it's 3/2 as much. These sound so okay because this second one's, this higher one's 3/2, the second one. Well, that note's bigger than double the original. It's 9/4. So I cut that in half to become 9/8. I have a new note. That's a brand new note. Now those two notes don't sound that good together. Right? They don't sound great together, but not horrible. The beginning of chopstick. Very fit interval. In music, this is called a major chord. When you play these three notes together. Called a what's that called? Any music people here? No? That has a special name to it. This chord has a special name. I can't remember. It's very famous. Suspended fourth. That has these two notes together. They don't sound that good together because they're the fractions, 9/8. But when you throw in this other note. What's that at the beginning of? She plays slower.
Minor.
Billy Joel song.
Song.
Yeah. Oh, someone just said it. Who's that? I just heard it muttered. Yes?
She's always a woman.
Yeah, she's always a woman to me. It begins with that. So he starts. So music is getting a little more interesting because that thing starts happening. Anyway. You can do this again. You take that 9/8 note and you multiply that by 3/2. And you get this note. That note's 27/16. I run into my first problem. 27/16 should be a decent sounding note because this is 3/2 of this, and this is 3/4 of that, and this is 3/2 of that. 27/16, not a bad note. The problem with 27/16 is that 20/16 is almost the exact same number as 5/3, which I already have a note for. And this, here we run into our first sort of dilemma in music. Should I have a note for 5/3, which is such a nice fraction, and a note for 27/16, which if you look at a calculator, 5/3 and 27/16, just to show you, five thirds is that, where 27/16 is that. They're so close they wouldn't even hardly sound different to the human ear. There's no way I want to have two different notes that sound almost exactly the same. So I'm going to use, when you use the 5/3, you're using something called just intonation. Just intonation is when you're trying to make fractions with the smallest possible numbers in them. Pythagorean tuning is when you're always doing 3/2 times the last note, maybe 3/4 times the last note if the 3/2 is higher than twice the frequency of the original. So I'm going to abandon my 5/3 note. And do 27/16 as my next note. When I take 27/16 and multiply that by 3/4, I get 81/64. Well, that's problematic because 81/64 is basically the same fraction as 5/4. So I lost two of my really nice notes. But I have a system now that will enable me to keep generating notes. Now something, just to continue with this, by the way, I'll give these notes names right now, modern sort of names. If the first note is called C, the two note is C, this 9/8 is actually D, this 81/64 is E, this 4/3 is F,
this 3 halves is G. The 20 over 16 is what we now call A. If I multiply 81 over 64 times 3 halves, I get 243 over 128. And that note's now called B. And with that, I have, I should mention, this four-thirds note has not really come up yet in this Pythagorean method. I mean, once I started with one note and multiplying by 3 halves, that four-thirds is just there from before. So if I go one more step with this B, take this 243. By the way, the B is really starting to sound not that good together. That sounds, they say, dissonant. If I take the B and cut that in half, it sounds like this together, which doesn't sound that good. But ironically, in modern music, they use this a lot. In the 1970s, they would take these two notes and add in these two notes to get this sound. And in the 70s, I can make up a 70 songs. This interval, which sounds so bad when they're together like that, but when you add these two notes, it doesn't sound so bad anymore. It's called major seventh chord, and you don't hear it as much anymore, but I promise you, if you go back to your 70s, a generic 1970s song. So I have here a bunch of notes. Right now, without that F, without that four-thirds note, I have... But here's something. So already, as I mentioned, it's not sounding that good. If you go one more time, you really run into a problem, because if you take the B note, which was 243 over 128, and multiply that by 3 over 2, you get a note that's somewhere around here, which would have a relative frequency to the original, 729 over 512. And that sounds like this together. And that's considered, there was a time that this was called, like, I think it was called like the devil's interval. You actually could not use this in music because of this, the way it sounded. This was worse. But ironically, let me see if I can do it right. I don't know what that is. No one knows? What famous television show? That's The Simpsons. The Simpsons. Interval. So that is a very, that interval wasn't used long ago. And modern composers, like in West Side Story, they use it a lot. Because nowadays, modern music, people like these intervals, and they try to use them. And I have a piano teacher who, you know, has studied music so much that music, you know, most music bores him because it doesn't use these, you know, he's bored of all like the regular nice intervals that we think sound good. So we say, well, you know, well, what do you like? And he's like, you know, and that's what he likes. But I mean, he can also appreciate, you know, the classics. And in modern music, not to embarrass him, Mr. Kalish's father is a prominent piano player who is a specialist in that kind of modern music that it takes you got to get used to it. You have to develop a taste for it. And
people who like that, you know, they really like it. But to me, it's a little, it's like going to modern art where there's like a big piece of paper with like a red square in the middle and like a tiny circle, and people are saying, that's brilliant. And it's I don't know if they really think it's brilliant, if they really are sophisticated, if they've gone through and been bored of just like a nice picture of a person and fruit, whatever. So, but dissonances are, musicians use them because they make us, they give us tension, you know, and it's supposed to, like, this is a famous thing in music, this chord, and then we want it to go. So tension happens because these two notes don't sound that great together. It's like, you know, please stop playing this note, and then yeah, that sounds nicer to me. So that's what happens in music. They actually utilize notes that aren't supposed to sound good together. But that note here doesn't sound that good, and right now we have, but we really want that other note, that fourth thirds note, and you can actually get the fourth thirds note, because if a note sounds good with 3/2 times it, it should also sound good with 2/3 times it, because 2/3 times 3/2 is 1, so those should sound decent together. And if you double that, you get the 4/3 note that we wanted. So I got back the 4/3 by cheating a little bit, doing Pythagorean tuning. So our 1 was the note we now call C, whereas our 3/2 was the note we'll now call G, and our 9/8 is the note that's now we're going to call D, and our 27/16 is A, and our 5/4 is E, and our 5/4. There is an 81/64, which is E. 243/128 is B. Now I mentioned that 729/512, which is actually F sharp, does not sound that good with the C. That was this, the Simpsons. So what you can start to do is go backwards like I did. If I multiply by 2/3, I get 2/3, which is too low. But if I double that, I get 4/3. And over here, once I arrange these notes in order from small to big, C ends up being the smallest, D is the next, I get what we now know as our 8-note scale. One thing about these 8 notes is that they're not evenly spaced. Like, if I take these 3 notes and try to go Mary Had a Little Lamb, E, D, C, D, E, 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 if I try to do it with F, it's not the same. This one does sound okay. That sounds okay, but this doesn't. Some of the notes are about 5% higher than the one before, and some are about 9% of the note before. So this is about 6% higher. If I 1 to 1.06 basically. Sorry about that, that's not true. C to D, it's 9/8. So it's 9/8. 1, Sterling? 9/8. Yeah, 13%. 12%. So this is about 12% different. This is about 12% different. But this one's about 5% different. So the notes are not evenly spaced, which is kind of unusual. If I go this other direction and multiply C by 2/3, I get 2/3, and we'll double that, get 4/3. That's a new note. If I keep going in the other direction, I get 16/9 as my next note, which is nowadays called B flat. If I multiply that by 2/3, I get 32/27, which is now called E flat. If I multiply that by 2/3, I get 128/81, now known as A flat. If I multiply that by 2/3, I get 256/243, now known as D flat. And if I multiply that by 2/3, I get 1024/729, which is now called G flat. Now those of you who play music, everyone knows who plays music, that G flat and F sharp are the same note. but actually they're not the same note, just in the modern piano, because they don't tune this way anymore. G flat and F sharp are the same note. But in Pythagorean tuning, they are two different notes that are extremely close together, because if you change those both into decimals, they're almost the same number, so we kind of have to pick one. But in doing so, we meet up in the middle when we do it that way, after 12 notes. And that's why they said, okay, those are going to be our 12 notes now. And when I play them all, when I play all the 12 notes. Now when you take those notes and you turn them all into decimals, I have over here on the left, with Pythagorean tuning, I have all those fractions that turned into decimals. And when I let me make this a little bigger. That didn't do it. That's not going to do it either. That's right, I'll leave it as it is. The D flat is 1.05 different from the one before, and if I calculate the percent change from each note to the next one, they're all approximately 1.05 or 1.07 higher than the note before. And that's why if I do this, it's either 7 or 5% higher. And these are also about, that's called a half tone. What famous song starts with that? It's not really a song, it's more of a movie theme. Yeah, so Jaws, I don't know what happens next. But that's a half tone. A half tone is approximately, if you're using Pythagorean tuning, it's either about 5% higher than the note before or about 7% higher than the note before. Now there's a problem here. It would be better if it was all the same percent. Because what this means is, if I'm playing my song and I play it a little bit higher, this one's not tuned to Pythagorean, it would sound a little weird, because the intervals, what we hear are intervals, and if the intervals aren't all the same, I can't play the thing in a higher key, because the notes, you know, going, even doing this, if I say I want to play that a little higher, it's like, wait a second, that's not 5% higher, that's 7% higher, it sounds slightly different to me, I don't like it. So that's a problem of Pythagorean tuning, that's why this instrument is not tuned with Pythagorean tuning. The next type of tuning is what's called just intonation. Just intonation is when, instead of using those fractions based on, instead of using these numbers, we still use 3 halves and 9 over 8, but instead of using 27 over 16, I use 5, I'll write it out here, 1, 3 halves, 9 eighths, but instead of using 20 over 16, I'll use 5 thirds, because I wanted to have that, and 81 over 64 is so close to 5 fourths, why not use 5 fourths, and this 243 over 128 is very close to 15 over 8. And even this F sharp G flat isn't that far from 45 over 32. And this D flat can be done as about 25 over 24. And this A flat can be about 8 over 5. This E flat can be 6 over 5. This could be 9 over 5. So when you use these other fractions with the smaller denominator, smaller numbers in them, you get something called just intonation. Just intonation, nice thing about just intonation is that you get back these two notes, the original two notes, two of the original notes that I wanted to have, the 5/3 note and the 5/4 note. Now I have them. But here's the problem with just intonation. If I take, here's all the decimals of the just intonation notes, and if I take those and compare the percent difference from one note to the next, those are all over the place. Some of them are 8% higher than the note before. Some are only 4% higher than the note before. Some are 5%, some are 6%. So when you have just intonation, you solve one crisis, you suddenly do have a note that's 5/4 times the original and a note that's 5/3. But you introduce a new crisis, now it's really bad. Now I really have to play, if there's a song, if I want to play Mary Had a Little Lamb in C, and someone says, well, why don't you play Mary Had a Little Lamb in D? Well, it sounds okay on this instrument, but on an instrument that's just intonation, it might sound completely out of tune. And that's why when you play the piano and you learn Pachelbel's Canon in D, you had to play it in D on an old instrument, because if you didn't, it wouldn't just sound higher, it would sound completely out of tune. So that's interesting about that. But people didn't want this. People said, you know, I wish that we could play in different keys. We have different instruments that we want to play together and sound in tune, so that's an issue also. So in I think it's in the 1700s, maybe 1800s, they scrapped the entire Pythagorean tuning just intonation system and said, let's just start from scratch. Can we resolve the problem? Can we resolve these problems that we have these notes that are different intervals from each other? So in order to do that, they say, okay, well, what do we want? Well, I definitely want to have a note that has frequency, you know, one. I have my original note. I definitely want to have a note that's double, so I have these two sounds. I want to have 12 notes still, because when we did the Pythagorean tuning, we ended up with 12 notes pretty much, and even though some of the notes were so close that we counted them as one note, basically only 12 notes kept appearing, and they all ended up being about 6% higher than the note before. So the clever idea they had was, every note is a certain percent higher than the note before. So I take my original note, and I multiply it by R, I would get my second note. And if I multiply that by R, I'd get my third note. And I want to keep doing that until I end up with getting back to my original note, 1R to the 12th power. Very simple. If 1R to the 12th power equals 2, R to the 12th equals 2, and R equals the 12th root of 2, a very ugly number. Remember, Pythagorean tuning was based on the fact that 3 over 2 is a very nice fraction. But if I do the 12th root of 2, I get this number, 1.0594, about 6%. And if I do that, if I make each note exactly 1.0594 or whatever times the note before, I will get exactly 12 notes. Every note will be exactly the same percent higher than the note before. And when you do that, you get something called equal temperament, sometimes known as well-tempered. And in maybe the 1700s or 1800s, they started tuning pianos that way. So now my notes are not based on fractions at all, but my first note is 1. My second note is the 12th root of 2. My third note is the 12th root of 2 squared, so on, up until I get to the 12th root of 2 to the 12th, which is back to 2. So what this means is, this nice interval, which is 3 over 2, is not really 3 over 2 anymore. It's the 12th root of 2 to the 7th power. If you take the 12th root of 2 and raise it to the 7th power, it's approximately 1.5. But it's not 1.5. If I say 2 to the parentheses 7 over 12, I get 1.4983. And that would make Pythagoras very upset. The entire Pythagorean tuning was based on the fact that a note sounds decent with a note that's 1.5 times as big as it. When violin players tune up, they go, they do that all the time. And they're listening for, as this girl said over here, the overtones, because when you play the G, C is in there also, you can hear it. But the C that you hear is the actual, the 1.5 times one. So what happens when a violin player tunes, their note in their head is 1.5, and then they have to adjust a little bit to, because it's not going to sound good with the piano. It's not tuned to 1.5, it's tuned to 1.498 something. And that's how our musical instrument is now. Now, when you multiply something by 1.059, and you keep doing that,
what you end up is with a function y equals 1.059 to the x power. And when you graph it, it looks like that. It's called an exponential curve. Which is why, if you look at a piano from the top, it has this very characteristic shape. Actually, the shape goes this way because it's the string's length that's actually getting smaller by 6% each time, but the frequency is going up, and that is why the piano has this characteristic exponential curve in it. Now, I want to... So I've talked about three different types of tuning: Pythagorean, just temperament, and equal temperament. I have... someone made this. It's really nice. They played... If you have a digital keyboard, you can sometimes set your tuning to these different types of tunings. So... they gave me the same song played on three different instruments. Let me find it. Library. Hold on a second. Playlist. So here you go. So here is an instrument played on what you think of as a regular piano, which is the well-tempered piano. So listen to this carefully so we can compare it to the same song played on different tunings. Now here's the same song played with just intonation. And here's the same song played with Pythagorean tuning. So you may have not heard much of a difference between those, but they are different. Now, I want to finish out by telling you something pretty crazy. We have 12 notes, as I mentioned, because just by chance, by doing this 3/2 thing, 12 notes came about. And then we messed around saying we want 12 notes now because we're used to 12 notes. But who says it had to be 12 notes? That just happened. Why not say I want there to be 17 notes that are equally spaced like that? All I'd have to do then is make my first note 1 and my second note the 17th root of 2. And in doing so, I can make 17 notes so that the last note is double the first, the 17th note is double the first, and they're all the same percent from each other. And other cultures do this. They have set 17 note scale, some other cultures. So some people have messed around with that, and as I mentioned, my piano teacher, he likes that also. Like, when you have these 17 notes, you have different notes that sound totally out of tune in our ears because we're so used to the 12 notes. But, you know, he's really, you know, he loves that because it's like this new experience, you know, that in music he hadn't been able to experience before. So I'm going to play for you a couple of songs that have, let me get these, hold on a second. Sorry, hold on one second. I'm a little confused about how to use an iPhone. Here you go. So here's, I think this is a 12-note guitar playing with a 17-note guitar. Thank you. called Truth on a Bus, for obvious reasons. There are some cultures that use even 51-note scale, so it's pretty crazy, but to us, we grew up with 12-note scale, most of us, and that's what we're used to. But no one says that has to be. Now here's a modern composer I want to play as a last thing. You hear a lot of dissonances. My daughter, when she was 6 months old, banging on the piano. And it was. That is. That's what that is. She was playing it away. I said, that sounds good. I put a shot on the record, and that is exactly what that is. That's not a modern, well, this is a modern composer a couple of years ago. Okay, so that's good for today. Thanks.